Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. I am Patrick Kanagasingham, Chief Operating Officer with Habitat for Humanity International. Many thanks to all our guests and all of you for joining us today as we examine the impacts of climate change on vulnerable communities and discuss the important integrated approach that center on people. Friends, we are just honored to have with us a very impressive panel. I'm going to share their names and very briefly share their bios. They have such impressive bios. I think it's only fair that I at least share the headlines. We have with us Anjali Mahendra, who is the Director for Global Research at the World Resource Institute. Anjali has been with the World Resource Institute for some time now, and she's currently co-leading the World Resource Institute's report towards a more equal city, a flagship of the organization's publication. She is working with other thought leaders. She's an expert in some critical areas that this report covers, and we are thrilled that Anjali is able to join us today. On the academic side, Anjali holds a master's degree in city planning, a master's of science in transportation, and a PhD in urban and regional planning, all from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, or MIT. She also has a bachelor's degree in architecture from the School of Planning and Architecture, New Delhi, India. Thank you, Anjali, for joining us. We also have with us Tom Mitchell, who is the executive director, International Institute for Environment and Development. Tom has a keen interest in leadership in a complexity and a research background on systems innovation, climate resilience, and anticipatory governance. Previously, he held senior roles with Climate KIC and was their chief strategy officer. And Tom has also worked for the Overseas Development Institute as well. Tom has a PhD from University College London, and has his undergraduate degree from Cambridge University. And we have Joseph Muturi joining us all the way from Nairobi, Kenya. Joseph is the chair of Slum Dwellers International. He's also he's a national community leader, and he's also the leader of the Kenyan Slum Dweller Federation as well. Since joining the Federation in 1998, Joseph has played a critical role in negotiating and implementing projects to strengthen security tenure and improving living conditions of urban poor communities in Kenya. And like I said, he's also the chair of Slum Dwellers International. So once again, a very warm welcome, panelists, and we are thrilled to have each of you. Friends, I just want to begin with a problem statement. We have a daunting challenge. According to the United Nations, 3 billion people will need adequate and affordable housing by 2030. We're talking almost 40% of a global population here. And this is the challenge, friends. Climate change has further amplified challenges associated with housing and is making some of the goals even harder to achieve. And here we are looking at the intersectionality between housing and climate change. Given that those most deeply affected by the global housing shortage are also most susceptible to increasingly frequent and I would say severe weather-related events caused by climate change, any measures to support climate change mitigation and adaptation must incorporate housing. So the core here is that housing ought to be at the, you know, at the center of some of the solutions that we seek. It also, just to state the obvious here, friends, climate change knows no borders. And at Habitat, we see that. From our operations throughout the US, where we are witnessing unprecedented heat waves to South Africa, where flooding has devastated formal and informal communities alike. To Southeast Asia, where typhoons are increasing in intensity, and climate change, it's fair to say, is here, and we absolutely need to adapt. Notably, COP27 conference had an unprecedented number of participants this year. We are told that over 40,000 people participated, which really shows the immense interest and attention that climate change is being given across all sectors. And yet, there's still much to be done to develop the solutions we probably needed, not just today or what we need tomorrow, but probably solutions that we needed yesterday. So Tom, I'm going to begin with you. I just want to tell the audience that even as I engage the panel, just be prepared, there would be an opportunity later for you to ask questions, and we'll make sure your questions are considered as well. So Tom, let me begin with you by asking, you were on site at the UN's annual climate conference, COP27, a few weeks ago in Sharm el-Sheikh in Egypt. What were your main takeaways from COP27? And more importantly, did you feel that conversations reflected the urgency of work to meet the mitigation and adaptation needs of human settlements as part of future goals? Over to you, Tom.
Well, thank you very much. Yeah, and delighted to be invited. Thank you so much. I think gone are the days where we can characterize COP in very simple terms. COP has become a global meeting place for many different types of organizations, for many different purposes. And so the fact that there were actually 49,000 people that were part of COP highlights the fact that people are coming from many different backgrounds. And so there's a negotiations component that you often hear a lot about on the news, which is often where there is a key reflection on whether or not COP has succeeded or failed. But now there is also a whole variety of other purposes for COP, one being an opportunity to host events and to have discussions and meetings between organizations trying to raise ambition, but also probably more than ever at COP27 was a sense that there's a trade fair component. There are now private sector organizations trying to sell their products and services as a way in which you might expect of a World Expo. And I think in that respect, it's very difficult to characterize the success or failure of COP in very simple terms. But if you take it from the perspective of poor households in potentially informal settlements in the developing world, I think you have to conclude that COP is not delivering at the speed and urgency that we need to see for many different reasons. One, clearly on the mitigation agenda, there is no clear commitment to phase out fossil fuels. In fact, there was a weakening of language. Secondly, on the adaptation side, we're not meeting the 100 billion financial pledge that was the public money pledge set many years ago that has just not been met. And equally, the long-term target for finance is not making significant enough progress. But what we did see was the establishment of a loss and damage fund, albeit with a lot of work to do to be able to get the details in place. But really importantly, for those households who are losing their homes, being forced to displace through some of the things that Patrick was referring to, there is the possibility under that mechanism that access to a form of compensation may be possible. Now, of course, we prefer not to get to that point, but it is important that that type of mechanism might get into place. Now, overall, my personal impressions of the event was that the action outside the negotiating room is now becoming much more important than the glacial pace within the negotiating room. And there you can see, I think, a lot of really interesting and ambitious ideas for tackling the challenges. And also at this COP, probably a greater exposure of work on housing and on construction and on the plight of people in those areas, probably more than ever. So I'm encouraged by the fact that there is a raising up of this issue, and the fact that we're having this event, I think, is a signal that there is momentum.
Thanks, Tom. And I mean, some of the salient points that you just highlighted, I would love to come back. But Angela, I'd like to bring you in here, and I really want us to bring a housing lens now. And I'm specifically interested in how to put housing really on the agenda for our leaders, governments, and others, given the significance and the potential for impacting progress in a meaningful way. So maybe just building on, segueing from what Pam shared, building on what Pam shared to my original question, and Jen bringing housing back to the core, would love to hear your thoughts, Angela.
Thanks a lot, Patrick, and thank you for having me. I agree with many of Tom's takeaways, just about the missing link to climate mitigation and the whole opportunity for affordable housing, the fact that we don't really talk about housing so much in the climate discussions on the mitigation side, but also on the adaptation side, just more and more you're finding because of climate disasters in rural areas, heavy droughts and so on, flooding, you have a lot of people coming to the cities, and urban housing is such a huge problem. The fact that they're landing up in the informal settlements that have basically zero resilience, the quality of shelter, the quality of urban services available to them is poor. Living conditions are poor, so they're moving from one bad situation to another bad situation. And we're seeing this playing out, but there is not at all much discussion about the adaptation and the upgrading that's needed for communities that live in informal settlements in urban areas. And I think for the first time, maybe with this loss and damage conversation and the financing that hopefully will be directed towards it, it gives us a chance to spotlight this issue of the severe shortage of good quality, climate resilient, affordable housing, and where is loss and damage happening in the cities? It's happening in some of these settlements that basically have zero resilience. So I think there is a way to really center housing issues now. You asked about, how do we bring it on the agenda? Now, one thing just to say right off the bat is it has been, part of the agenda. I mean, if we talk about the SDGs, they have a target there on number of people living in slums and trying to reduce that number. There have been reports by McKinsey and others in the private sector talking about what is the big problem with affordable housing? Why does there continue to be a shortage? It is the lack of land supply in cities. And of course, Cities Alliance, the World Bank, there's so many organizations, Habitat for Humanity, that have been spotlighting this issue for a long time. But you make a good point. We're not moving the needle. And the problem there is also just how these efforts are directed, right? So national governments have targets for reducing the housing gap in particular countries. Look at Brazil, look at Mexico, look at South Africa, look at India. So many countries have actually even put housing as a basic right in their national constitutions. They have national policies for affordable housing. But the problem we're seeing is that a lot of these goals that they set in these policies are very quantitatively oriented. So we need to build these many millions of housing units. And there's not much regard paid to or consideration given to the location of where that housing comes up. Is it going to displace people from already existing places where they have livelihoods, where they have social connections, social networks, to locations where no services, no such social networks, no livelihood opportunities exist? And that's the big problem we have. So you see a situation where you have, famous stories from places like Mexico, where you have abandoned housing in the outskirts of cities, disconnected from services, hundreds of thousands of vacant homes because they never had any access to transportation or water supply or reliable energy or sanitation. And they're built often in climate risk prone zones. So unstable hillsides, riverbanks, and so on. And of course, this happens because of a few reasons. This happens because of the way government subsidies are designed, where they basically incentivize the building of these homes on cheap land, where regulations are weaker, and that's where developers can build at scale. Developers don't want to deal with issues of land tenure and the complexity of acquiring land to build housing. Resources for infrastructure and service delivery at the local level are so limited. So cash-strapped local governments are trying to build housing, but without any of the supporting infrastructure. And lastly, we have the prevalent and growing challenge of informality that Tom also mentioned. Informal housing, informal settlements, self-built, that is growing in so many rapidly urbanizing countries, but is completely unrecognized in government plans, The populations that live there are unrecognized in censuses. There's almost a sense that if we provide services and better housing and to these settlements, we legitimize them. And so there is a big challenge there that we face in terms of how can you design approaches, and I'm sure Joe will talk about this, to work with governments to actually upgrade informal settlements, make them more climate resilient, use the upgrading of housing in these places as a conduit for providing all those essential services that people need to live a healthy life. Thanks.
Thanks, Anjali. And you underscored how we look at informality and slum upgrading. And I do have a question or two, again, based on the intersectionality between informality and climate change. But for now, I just want to bring you back, and I have a follow-up question for you, Anjali, so please don't go away. Taking a global view and perhaps giving examples in specific regions, what has enabled resilience and adaptation in the built environment? What promising solutions have you seen that could be replicated or scaled in other contexts?
Yeah, so, you know, I'll come back to this issue of, I mean, we know from evidence around the world, whether it was, you know, a climate disaster like Katrina, Hurricane Katrina in this country, in the US, the floods in Pakistan, recurring cyclones in places like Bangladesh, or even the pandemic, right? That access to decent housing and urban services is crucial for building household level and community resilience. And when it's lacking, you, of course, have the vulnerable communities, poor communities bearing the brunt, but even worse of a brunt because their homes are the first to be destroyed. They suffer lasting health impacts, loss of incomes, loss of livelihoods, often creating all kinds of the expenditures that they need to make to just get over an event like this, a climate disaster like this, often traps them into debt burdens. So there is, I think, no question in my mind and the evidence that we've gathered around the fact that if cities could provide for resilient, good quality, affordable housing packaged together with all the infrastructure and services, water and sanitation and access to energy and transportation that goes along with it, that can help build climate resilience immensely. Now, some good examples. I talked earlier about how we have often country level housing policies that are essentially location blind, right? They're not about the quality of the housing and its connectivity to services and opportunities. They're about meeting quantitative targets. And there's some places, in fact, even Mexico, learning from the poor experience of the past years where this was not a consideration, they have reformed their policies. You have Brazil, you have India now looking at particular locations within cities that are well connected to public transit, that are well connected to jobs, and prioritizing those locations as part of urban planning exercises. It has different names in different places. It's called urban operations in Sao Paulo and Brazilian cities. It's called town planning schemes in India. But trying to come up with a way to generate that supply of land in well-connected, well-located places, away from climate risks, where you can build affordable housing. Because that is, at the end of the day, a big roadblock for affordable housing. Where do you generate the supply of land? So there are examples, and also trying to build in actually measures to finance the supporting infrastructure through land value capture and so on. Another kind of solution area is just being able to put a spotlight and bring data on the gap that exists. And here again, I'm going to highlight, because I'm so appreciative of the work that Slum Dwellers International does and Joe's team on this Know Your City campaign that they have going, where they work with communities living in informal settlements to say, hey, cities are not gathering the data on the needs that you have, the lack of access to services, the quality of housing, the poor living conditions, the coping mechanisms you use every day to simply get through life. Can we have communities gathering that data themselves? And can we have standardized approaches to do that so that they gather that data and then bring it to the attention of city decision makers and really take a seat at the table that, hey, here's the picture of the problem and what can we do to address it together and actually join forces with city governments to bring better infrastructure, better housing, better water and sanitation services. And I think Mukuru, the settlement in Nairobi, where I know Joe works, but many others across Kenya, there places in India where Mahila Housing Trust works, this is the model they're trying to adopt. You know, bring the community gathered data to decision making and use it as a way to lobby for the needs and services and work with city governments. Another thing I'll point out is the need for financing being directed to where the need is greatest. You have big national financing programs, you have climate financing programs that have existed. The problem is they're not, the financing is not funneled through to where the most vulnerable communities are. We just don't have mechanisms for that. Global financial organizations like the World Bank and IMF don't have mechanisms for that. Climate funds don't have mechanisms for that. And there, again, we've seen some good examples. Like there is this devolved climate finance alliance in Africa, which is bringing communities together with donors and national governments to funnel those funds to build the right housing and services where it's needed. You also have programs like the Ban Man Kong program across Thailand and Southeast Asia, where again, donors joining forces with national governments and communities are being able to funnel the funds to build this kind of housing. One last thing I'll say on solutions is we also need to kind of really get beyond the excessive focus on home ownership. I think there's this whole industry, you know, the financialization of the home, real estate finance sector and emphasis on home ownership that that makes housing unaffordable sometimes for the majority. If we could focus much more on flexible arrangements, like make rental markets more accessible at all income levels, focus on plot size, planning standards, right? Plot sizes, densities, and so on, so that a range of housing options are available for a range of income groups in cities to meet their affordability levels, I think we could really also move the needle on this much more. So just a tapestry of many types of solutions for which many examples exist that I can certainly talk about more in detail later. Thanks.
No, I'm just smiling to myself, particularly when you made reference to the flexibility in terms of when we pursue options, not to just focus on one possible solution like home ownership, but that there are other approaches that we ought to consider. And that's precisely what Habitat for Humanity is in the business, trying to look at the various options, the various contexts and possibilities. It's not a one-size-fits-all approach. You know, as much as home ownership could be just one solution, but there are other options as well. I just want to bring Joe here, Joe in at this point. Joe, you heard this, you lived this in terms of the work that you do. SDI or Slum Dwellers International is doing a huge amount of work in this space, particularly when it comes to informality. Joe, what approaches Slum Dwellers International, for example, encouraging to support people and communities in informal settlements? Quite frankly, let's face it, and you know, we use the term incremental a lot because that's what upgrading is mostly about. But would want to hear from you, your firsthand experience, and I personally would love to share some as well, based on, you know, the communities that I've engaged with, particularly over the past few months. But let me first ask you to weigh in and give your perspective, Joe.
Thank you very much, Patrick. And to be honest, Anjali has kind of exhausted all the solutions I have. But basically, just before I read on the solutions, just my takeaway from COP, which will take a little bit of time. So one thing about COP is that I think the housing discussion is getting there. I think we are getting a seat in the negotiating table. But part of the challenges is that the reason why it's not gaining traction as fast as we would want it to be, we are lumping everything together as climate change. You'll find that the people who are working on houses and the challenges of informality and the effects of informality and effects of climate change in informal settlements are being lumped together with ocean risk, marine risk. So I think it's the high time now we have very specific discussions and we don't deal with generalities, we deal with specific issues. What are the challenges of climate change now in the informal settlements? The other thing, the discussion might take around COP, I still believe, and I can say, and to be on record, the discussion is still a little bit elitist. How do we make sure that we start now localizing the discussion? We start having this discussion at the community level, city level. By the time we get to the other COP, all these solutions are coming from the ground. For me, the takeaway from COP was that we have all this bunch of people who agree there's a problem of climate change and something needs to be done. But the people who face the really devastating effects of climate change were not on that table. And I promised them the next time I go to the other COP, I'll take $100 with me to talk about these challenges that they are facing. The other thing, SDI, as we have been pushing for more recognition of the effects of climate change in cities. And we are saying you cannot have a discussion around climate change and you don't bring in cities. This is where the most pollution happens and this is where the most devastating effects happen. I understand, yes, and we acknowledge that there are effects elsewhere, deforestation, the challenges in the rural, but I don't think it's fair not to have the discussion around cities when you talk about climate change. And the other thing, like I said, in cities is where we have the most devastating. So part of the challenge, I think slum dwellers have been facing all these challenges, and I would go to start enumerating the challenges that come with living in informal settlements. But now there's a new phenomenon that has come in. Initially, slum dwellers used to resist evictions from the private developers, from the city who want to create, city managers who want to create space for playgrounds and parkings. But now there's a new phenomena we are experiencing. It's being called evictions by climate change. The flooding is more pronounced. The rivers are busting their banks and sweeping houses, causing deaths and destructions. So that's a new phenomena that we have to deal with, and we have to talk about cities. And for me, who have been doing this, been in this process for the last 24 years, as Anjali was explaining, part of the, for us, we focus more on addressing what are the solutions and how do we partner with cities and national governments. And one of our key pillars is creating partnerships. The reason I say we create partnerships when it comes to even issues around the provision of housing. As civil society, as much as we mobilize resources, they will never be enough. But how do we make this sustainable? How do we use the little resources we have to leverage and to partner with cities and to build more houses? That is number one. She also mentioned the issue of data collection. And one of the missing links has always been cities don't have capacity. Our city managers, our municipal managers, they don't have the data. They don't have information of informal settlements. If you ask, if you go to Nairobi at City Hall, ask one of the planners, how many cities, how many slums, informal slums, how many slums in the city of Nairobi? They will tell you Mathare, Kibera, Mukuru, and maybe Korogosho. But I can tell you for a fact, there are around 200 slums within the city of Nairobi. So with this information, we don't go to the negotiating table empty-handed. This is information we provide, that something that they don't have. But what do we get from the data that we provide? We seek partnerships, we seek a seat in the negotiation table, we seek a seat when they are setting and budgeting and setting the agenda of the city for the next 1 year. We get a slice of the cake. So that's important. Data is important. And now we are beyond the usual data we collect about services, how many toilets, water points. We are also adding more data. We are doing risk mapping. We are doing vulnerability mapping. How many slums in the next 5 years won't be there? Because they are in the riparian. They will be washed away by rain. They are sitting on very risky and dangerous area and high voltage lines. So that is the information now we are adding in our city profiles. And we are telling the city, hey, look, there's a challenge here. If we don't do something about this now, this is what is going to happen. So we work and we try to work with cities to provide solutions. So when you come to housing and Patrick, bear with me. Housing is not a priority for many governments. It's not on discussions. Just to share a very horrible joke, we were looking at one of the counties that we work in. We realized entertainment in the government, in the governor's office gets more money allocated than the planning, than the housing department. So there's more money for sausages and samosas, that there are more money to provide and to set up. And somebody talked about policies. All these policies are there, very nice policies, but they are not being implemented. Nobody, it's only the city, they are somewhere tucked in the files, very safe. Nobody knows about, it's not being implemented. How do we make sure that all these policies are implemented? How do we push for these policies to be implemented? Lastly, civil societies tend to work, and I'm happy Anjali mentioned about the Mukuru Special Planning Area. This is one area that we took lead. We first of all was to fight an eviction of almost 100,000 households. They sit on private land. They have been there for the last so many years. They were facing an evictions, and they were being told, you pay 60 million or you move for a two or for a 1 acre land. So we, what we did, and why Mukuru is special to us, we mobilized 40 institutions, and we also recognized that the city doesn't have never undertaken a project of this magnitude. We mobilized 40 institutions, both academic, civil societies, international NGOs, and the role was to help the city to come up with a land use plan for the for Mukuru, and that is why you called the Mukuru Special. It was looking at how is that, and this is basically what the committee. It was basically a community very bottom up strategy where the city committees were telling the city. We don't have, this is the number of schools we want, these are the places that we want, this is how we want the road infrastructure, and we are happy after a 2 year period, the government has come in, they have brought infrastructure, they are building hospitals, they have built a very good road network, and now they are going to put up 13,000 housing units. So for civil societies to stop working, everybody in their little corner, how do we bring in our resources, our manpower, our skill set, and help support? And let's address the issue of informality. Let's address the issue of housing. Not part of these challenges, we usually take them, the problems of slum dwellers, those are their problems. How do we make it our problem? How do we make it our problem collectively? And this business of cities, taking slum dwellers 60 kilometers away, dumping them there. Anjali talked about this. That is the quickest, easiest solution. Get a private developer, build 5,000 units, get rid of the slum dwellers. You don't have a game plan of how they are going to connect to the city. They don't have a game plan of the infrastructure. You are destroying a social fabric that has been proven, no schools, no. So we need to have our game plan in place. And for us, we say slum dwellers, poor people, have a right to participate in the city. So there's no use of taking them 40 kilometers away from the city. That is why we encourage in situ slum upgrading and bringing in services. I hope I haven't taken much of my time.
No, Joe, and I just want to underscore a lot of what you said. So, for example, your reflections and your provocations, I would say, are consistent, particularly when it comes to how we look at informality. And I just want to maybe focus on, I promised that I would come back to informality. And I think it's time that we do it as far as this particular conversation is concerned. I was in Pretoria, Joe, as you know, I think it was just a couple of months ago when the South African government and UN Habitat co-sponsored the global, action plan, and looked at a framework. And what was interesting, I thought, just hearing from UN Habitat, the head of UN Habitat, is terminology. And the terminology was no longer, we are not going to say slum upgrading any longer, we are going to use the term slum transformation. Joe, help us understand and appreciate what that pivot in language really means, because that definitely, again, has this correlation with what we're talking about today.
For us, I think the way we have been approaching, when we talk about upgrading, Now we are looking at providing, we are looking at housing just beyond, call it whatever you want, transformation upgrading. We are looking at housing beyond the four walls. So for us, if a community doesn't have water, as clean, an adequate supply of clean drinking water, and you provide that, that is steps towards upgrading. When a community doesn't have a road infrastructure, doesn't have a service, they are not connected to the sewer, they are not connected to the other part of the city, that is transformation. So let's look at, we are looking at housing, it's looking at housing beyond the four walls, it's looking at housing more from a planning perspective, a land use perspective. We are now looking at housing at a, with a climate angle. Yeah, how do we make our buildings more resilient? How do we make our neighborhoods friendly, create public spaces? How do we recycle? How do we take care of our disposals? And for me, all these terminologies, they will keep on changing. Yeah? But the fact remains, so if you talk about the climate change space, we started with global warming. It came to climate change. Then it came to adaptation, mitigation. Now we are the latest one was loss and damage. We will keep on changing this terminology. But as long as we don't put these discussions, these campaigns we are launching, if we don't put it into practice, these words will mean nothing. And to remind you, somebody once said, slum dwellers don't want to be called resilience anymore. They want the challenges to be taken care of now, not for the future, now. They said, we don't want to be called resilience. We don't know what you might call us next.
Right. So, Joe, I thank you for that. And Tom and Anjali, I want to bring you in as well. And I'm just going to bring the different components of what we discussed today. We looked at COP27. We asked some critical questions about just not conversations that took place. But if I may be, again, somewhat provocative, I think I would even ask the question, so what would change between COP27 and COP28 when it comes to some related points, including what Joe just highlighted concerning slum transformation, SDGs. And a lot has been said about both adaptation and mitigation. So let me ask this question. Tom, let me begin with you. And let's be brief, because I just want to make sure there's an opportunity for the audience to weigh in as well. What would change, or what should change, as far as COP28 is concerned, Tom? How do we, we've talked about acceleration, we've talked about accountability, we've talked about transparency. What should change as far as 28 is concerned, so that we can also bring housing back and put it at the core of the climate agenda?
So I think it's interesting to note the way in which COP27 was one of the first times where food systems were really extremely prominent. And I think it's therefore important to learn from some of the other agendas that have come from, I suppose, a less visible standpoint, really at to the fore. And I think some of that is for the kind of global community working on housing to work in a much more integrated way to think about its visibility at COP events, if indeed that is the goal. I think also to note that actually the vehicle of COPs is one for driving ambition. And therefore, what is it that COP can be used for in order to be able to create the political pressure for announceables, for focusing the building of movements of organizations to tackle certain things? Now, I think the opportunity of COP28, given the fact that the loss and damage fund was agreed at COP27, there's going to be a huge amount of attention given to the design principles of that fund. Who's going to get access to it? How's the money going to flow? How much money is there going to be? What's the distributional element? What are the goals we're setting for it? And so on. Well, actually, surely one of the key topics that we should be asking for here is how do we make sure that that money can be accessible to those who are seeking housing justice, those who have been experiencing the impacts of climate change? How can there be access to those funds to make sure that we can build safe, secure, low carbon housing with the right kinds of tenures and ownership structures? There's an opportunity here driven by that loss and damage agenda in order to raise housing up the agenda. But here, I think it's valuable not just to think about slums and informal settlements, but actually to think about the future of housing on a global basis, where housing is something that is a topic that links everybody. It's the thing that you and me and anybody else on the planet can talk about together, because there are a common set of things that we can identify with. And those, you know, in parts of Europe or in North America, in social housing and so on, where the topics are very much around cladding and energy efficiency and energy costs and so on, there are similar kind of challenges with climate change that are being faced in all countries. So I think this is a magnificent opportunity for a genuine global movement, but it's going to take organizations probably getting a little bit out of their comfort zone and working in ways in which they become more campaign oriented, more global in focus, more understanding of the impacts of climate change on those houses or housing and the challenges that and opportunities that climate change can bring. So I think that's important. Two other very quick points. It really is wrong just to think about annual cycles of COPs, right? It's much better if you think about what to achieve over several COPs. And actually, this is a really interesting moment now where Australia has already put its hand up to say, we will host COP in 2026. And what we want to do is to try and create a pathway for different governments to work together through hosting COPs to be able to achieve longer term outcomes if we set a 4-year time horizon. So I'd say rather than just necessarily a global community of organizations focused on housing, thinking about COP28, let's think about a multi-year, multi-dimensional strategy to achieve a very different outcome, not just in 1 year, but over 4 years. Last point I'd want to raise is that there is an aspect now of new technologies coming into the housing space. Maybe not all of them are appropriate for informal settlements, but that those technologies, I think, need to be embraced, whether it relates to issues of biomimicry, looking at the performance of houses that act like nature for greater resilience, for looking at building materials in a way that can be both low carbon and resilient as well. We need to embrace that technology edge in order to create the best possible outcomes. Very final point, and I know it's time for taking questions, but I do think there's another danger that hasn't necessarily been talked about. Joseph highlighted that we're now seeing climate evictions. Mm. I also think seeing the weaponization of climate data for achieving certain political goals. So people are not being able to get access to that data in the same way yet. Concerns about the threats of climate change to certain areas is being used somewhat as an excuse to create evictions. And I think we're seeing that in Lagos and in parts of Indonesia as well. So access to fair, equitable climate data about the future of parts of cities is a really important component of a housing justice debate in the context of climate change. Otherwise, I think we'll see increasing evictions that are made politically palatable under the guise of concerns about the impact of climate change.
Thanks a lot, Tom. Tom, I just want to maybe just highlight and draw out what you said about the weaponization or the politicization. Sometimes being political is important if you have to put it on the national agenda. And Anjali, I would love to ask you the question is, you know, it's not so much the distinction or the subtle variance between what gets weaponized versus what gets put on the national agenda, because you need national governments and governments in general to subscribe to the significance of putting housing just not on the agenda, but also looking at the intersectionality between housing and climate change. What is it? What's the role of civil society here, Anjali, in really working with national governments to make it happen?
And just in a quick response, Patrick, I would say the role is to try and make sure key actors are all on the table, that this doesn't remain, as Joe was saying, this elitist conversation. COP has always had national governments there, subnational presence also, city level actors, civil society actors has been smaller, growing, but it's been relatively small. But it becomes the place where we can start to draw those connections between subnational governments, city governments that recognize the needs on the ground, the shortage that they need to address, the gaps in access to housing, and make the case to national levels of government for directing financing, to include planning for the for these settlements, or making sure land supply is created for affordable housing, making sure all of that is part of national adaptation plans, making sure it's part of NDC commitments that national governments are making. So the subnational and national link is something that I think civil society organizations step in within countries, but also at the global level to make. And the other is making sure actors like SDI, like local community groups working hard every day in cities, are also at the table, because the most innovative solutions come out of that. Joe already talked about the Mukuru example. We have some great, we have lessons to learn from other places like Bangladesh, which has been seeing recurring cyclones and all kinds of climate risks, sea level rise and so on. I heard recently how about 2,000 people arrive from the countryside, the rural areas of Bangladesh, into Dhaka city every day. And they come to basically the closest relative's place in the informal settlements, which are unserviced, often again in very climate risky areas. They move from one bad situation to another bad situation, and they come in search of livelihoods. This has happened on a recurring basis. Bangladesh at the national level is now thinking of these, using climate funds to invest in these climate, what are they calling them? Migrant-friendly, climate-resilient towns and cities, where they're looking at a comprehensive package of shelter, so housing and infrastructure, but also education and livelihood opportunities that can bring the youth in there and, you know, really help rebuild lives for future generations with a long-term view. Very interesting example. And I think, again, to also chime in a bit on what Tom was saying, COPs become a great place where we can learn from the experience of some of these other groups in other countries and share that so that, again, we show up. We not only work in an integrated way to make this movement happen, as Tom is saying, which I agree with completely, but we also learn from each other and we become that convening actor to help bring subnational and national levels together, but also the multiple stakeholders that need to come together to address this.
I love the point that you made about and that example that you gave about the migration that you're talking about, Dhaka city, and the numbers, the 2,000 odd people really making it to the city. And I, Joe, if I could turn to you, because there's a question from the audience that's related, and I would like you to take this question. And the question is this: rentals are a large part of informal settlements. How can we ensure that needs of renters are also brought forward into the climate housing imperatives agenda?
I think, as someone said earlier, that the housing agenda shouldn't be just about informal settlements. This is an agenda that connects all of us, whether you are a renter, whether you are a structure owner. And for us within informal settlements, the people who own these structures are called structure owners. They are not landowners. It's a discussion that brings everybody on board. And the way we have been doing it, and I think for whoever asked the question, how do we get organized? How do we come up with our own solutions? So one of the things, and this is something that we have tried, tested, and it worked, how do we sit down and formulate our own solutions? And how do we get the city or the government to support these initiatives? How do we become part of the discussion? Whether you're a renter, you're a landlord, this is a discussion that unites everybody. It's a city discussion. The housing discussions unite everybody. So one of the things, and the solution is, and for us, when I talked about getting a seat in the negotiating table, how do we amplify the solutions that are being, the solution that neighborhoods, communities are coming? How do we support those initiatives? Because as much as they are challenges, the people have a way of coping, people have a solution to. If you used to go to Mukuru a while back before they built, they dug drainages for the stormwater, they had a way they used to take care of that water, they had a way they used to. How do we take these solutions and make them better? For me, I will tell how do we start a discussion among communities, among the neighborhoods, regardless of who you are, enter. And then how do we take this discussion to City Hall? How do we co-design solutions with the city? How do we, even beyond co-designing, we co-create, we co-design, we budget together, and then we implement together. But the challenge is most of us just wait, and we sit and wait for solutions to come. We sit and wait and complain to the city. And SDI, what we have been doing is try to push. This is what communities are doing to mitigate around this. These are what, so how do we create stronger neighborhood association that can be able to negotiate with the city? And one thing I just mentioned, just to pick up the discussion, and Ajeli had mentioned before, there's so much discussion around resources on climate change, all this money, all these pledges. We hear there are several billions flying around all over the place, but where is this money? Where is it going? Because we are not feeling it. And Ajeli mentioned, actually, this money is not going to people actually who need these resources the most. Why is this money being captured? And that's the question he asked me. Even at COP, there was all this discussion. This one has 8 billion. That one has 100 billion. Where are these resources going?
Okay. Thanks, Joe. There's a lot of interest from the audience as far as this topic is concerned, and the questions keep coming in. And this is what I'm going to do. I am just going to use my privilege as a moderator to really align two questions, because I believe the points are related, and I'm just going to defer to the panel, and I would love each of you to maybe either quickly weigh in, or if one person wants to take it and you know talk about it, that's fine as well. So there's a comment and a question. In the comment is, we've talked about COP27 today. COPs are clearly driving the conversation and a clear focus for the movement on housing. But what else do we need to be pushing in order to push this agenda globally? And I think the related piece for me is this. It's about just not the conversations. It's about how do we actually inspire and instill hope even as we seek solutions. Because Joe, to your point, looking at informality, looking at the numbers, 1 billion people, the numbers are staggering. We looked at housing, we looked at 3 billion people by the year 2030 if you know we don't take adequate action. So these are the two questions. So the first one is about COP27, right? What else should we be really doing to pushing the agenda globally? Anjali, you mentioned the SDGs. You talked about the role of national governments, et cetera. And then the related piece is the hope. Okay, so what hope can we instill and what can we inspire in order, like even leading up to COP28? So who would like to go first?
I'd like to go first, Patrick.
Go for it, Joe.
Mm-hmm. I said, please. Initially, how do we cascade this discussion down? How do we remove these discussions and this we have? All is not lost. There's hope because people and more, I can talk about sub-Saharan Africa, are recognizing this flooding, these heat waves. These are not acts of God. They are recognizing climate. They are recognizing the role of climate change in that. Even farmers are recognizing this has got nothing to do with witchcraft. This is climate change. We have not had rains for 3 seasons. This is climate change. There's hope, the discussion. We are working with a project. Personally, we are working in informal settlement with young people. We want to turn them into climate champions. We want to mainstream the discussion around climate champion. By the time you go to the next COP, people are talking about not about the challenges. And that is what SDI is all about. We are talking about solutions. How do we get these solutions to be supported? How do we get these solutions to be amplified? How do we learn from each other? How does COP become a center and a forum for sharing ideas, knowledge transfer, apart from just complaining this is happening? I think let's stop crying and move. The other thing, when you talk about how do we make this a priority, I think, like I said, most governments, they come. Even beyond the COPs, even at the United Nations Habitat, the Governing Council, every city mayor, every government will come and provide for them. The magic number is usually 10,000 houses. The most ambitious ones, they usually say 100,000 houses. I'll do 100,000 houses per year. Yeah. Then they'll come after 2 years, promise the same thing again. How do we make them accountable? How do we monitor? Yeah. The last time you promised us 10,000, you have built zero. How do we make sure that this becomes an agenda, it becomes a priority on the pecking order and the list of how? So now the national government, for us, I like to put a context of Kenya. The national government is doing some houses in Nakuru. They launch another one with UN Habitat in at the river, but the rest of the counties are quiet. They are very, because national government is doing that. That is the role of national government. How do we bring our concerted efforts, our resources, and address the issues of housing? But we will keep on talking. How do we now start walking the talk?
Thank you, Joe. And Anjali and Tom, you have 30 seconds each. Continue to inspire us. Give us some hope here.
Thanks, Patrick. So quickly, I do see hope as well. There's so many shining examples. Joe just talked about Mukuru, but there are many others. Mahila Housing Trust is doing in Ahmedabad, working with communities to deal with heat risks, flooding risks, working with the city. We can talk about multiple examples, even across Latin American cities. The disconnect, so a lot of hope. The disconnect is that at global events like the COP, we are not getting through with these examples, these bottom-up examples from cities and communities to the levels of decision-making at the national and global scale that we need to have happen. So that is the disconnect. I would also say you asked a question, Patrick, about who else needs to be, or how is it all about a COP conversation and a climate conversation? Not really. Global conferences and meetings like the COP give one opportunity to discuss particularly that intersectionality with climate and housing. But within countries, we need to be engaging housing finance organizations, development banks, private developers. And one quick example I'll give is, you know, Latin America, again, there's been a lot of experience with failed examples of housing in the outskirts and so on. Now they're trying to particularly talk to private developers, you know, what is not working about our existing municipal incentives to build affordable housing in zones that are connected to public transit or connected to opportunities. And so really going one step further to find out first what those barriers are and then break it down. We've been doing some of that work with the IDB. So I think we do have many other actors to engage here, even outside of the traditional climate actors. Thanks.
Thank you, Anjali. And Tom, in 20 seconds.
Yeah. 20 seconds. So less than 10% of money from international climate funds is actually getting to the local areas and to local communities. And even when that 10% gets there, there are real suggestions that actually they're being spent on the wrong things and often makes things worse. So what Joe is highlighting, that he's not seeing the money, is absolutely true. So the multilateral system for delivering that money to where it's needed isn't working, and that's becoming increasingly more widely recognized and discussed. So the challenge for many of those on this call is to say, what's our proposal? What's the plans? How can we work together to provide that delivery structure for what's needed? Because if we wait and expect somebody else to be providing that delivery structure, it's not going to work. The money is around, the options are there. Let us get around the table and design something that works for the communities that we work with.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Anjali. Thank you, Joe. This has been a very inspiring conversation and a very significant conversation, I would say, colleagues, concerning climate change and the intersectionality with housing. I would like to put it across this way. I'm hoping this is the beginning of a series of conversations that we would have, just not leading up COP28, but just bringing putting housing on the agenda, making sure that we are proactive. We would make it as robust as possible. But more importantly, like Tom said, without waiting for someone else to act, let's put that onus back on us when it comes to accountability and transparency as well. So can I thank each of you and thank the audience? This has been a wonderful conversation and I've thoroughly enjoyed it. Take care.